blasted out of my sleep 6 o'clock in the morning. Some maniac outside leaning on his car horn, gotta go outside and teach him the proper etiquette. Neighborhood bad enough, can't let it get worse than it already is. You hear me? I need my sleep. That's the only time on this planet that I ever get any peace. I tried that college thing on some American dream tip, but yet I still live on the same streets that I grew up on. The same streets that I grew tough on. My mother hoped that I would surpass at least to the middle class, but yet I'm still stuck on that same mentality. And all those years of college ain't even challenged me. But when I graduated, life was right there to put a degree in my hands and a foot on my chest. And here I am dressed in my pajamas and no slippers, about to run outside and rip the backbone out. This fool ain't got nothing to show for all those years of school but bad credit and even worse decisions. And I live in a neighborhood where people buy food on credit, so they finance, but they don't just take, and they're making payments on food that they already ate. When they see me on the street, they're looking at me like they're about to break, and I'm snatching open this door like I'm about to break, and I see my best friend. And he's sitting in a minivan with four of those child car seats, and he's looking at me with a gun in his hand. It's like I can hear his heart beating. With his other hand, he takes a swig of liquor from a bottle of scotch, pops the door locks like it in. Moves the pictures of his children off the car seat with the gun, throws them in a glove box, and it's like everything stops. And we drive, and we drive, and we drive till we get to the part of town where it seems like the American dream is still alive. And in my mind, I'm playing Nina Simone as I'm looking out the window on the passenger side. And it's like somebody scraping their fingernails along my bones as I feel this grown man cry, and I wonder if he knows that tens of millions of people in this country are depressed but using alcohol or drugs to remain in denial. I wonder if he knows that there's a suicidal tendency hiding behind almost every smile, because no matter how many times they go back to school or how many jobs they work simultaneously, they can never seem to permanently change their lifestyle. But somehow, they convince themselves that it'd be different for their children. And eventually, they realize that's a fantasy, but they need something to believe in until then. And him, he just wants to be a father to his children. But sometimes, y'all, after all the love is gone, children become pawns in a relationship. And his relationship with his children is the vehicle that his ex-wife chooses to take out her frustrations with. And if he's just one day late on the child support, she reports it to the court. And what's driving him crazy is yesterday, he just got laid off now. 30 days ago, him and the kids just moved in with a new man who drives a Range Rover and plays golf. And that's a year ago from the day that my best friend had to go to jail for making her last boyfriend stop telling the children that their father was soft. And right now, he feels like everything's lost. That's why I'm glad he came to me to give me this opportunity to put a few thoughts across. And you see, all day and all night, we talk. And I tell him, a man is judged by what's in his soul and what's in his heart, and not just by what's in his pockets. I tell him, me and him are friends who thick and thin, and if he's in pain, we need to put our brains, time, and money together to stop it. I tell him that the fact we don't have a lot of money is a problem, then rather than getting fed up, what we need to do is wake up, and like Moses and Jacob, whenever we get together, just find new ways to profit. Because in my eyes, our friendship is how we live and how we die. And don't you ever believe that even for a second that I would ever let you slide. Now, what I'm about to say, I want you to listen with all your pride and sexuality aside, because as God is my guide, like my own self, I love you. Yeah. I'm told a bikini ain't a bikini unless you can pull it through a wedding ring. And I ain't never been excited about trading one for the other until I saw you and yours. And I was floored like laying in sand as I glanced from your legs to your hips to your eyes and looked immediately to your left as if I thought I could guess your ring size. And seriously, I was surprised to find that your ring finger was bare. I started thinking, I don't know where this woman is from, but apparently they ain't got no real men living there. And Lord knows I seen swimwear. And with legs like those, yours just ain't fair. And I ain't into hating on nobody, but when the body is yours, I just can't share. See, when it's right, they say you hit it and quit it. But when it's perfect, you hit it and live it. And get with rings and tennis bracelets, go shopping for shoes and take cruise vacations. Even your smile is a call to action. So when I say you're a place of mind, I'm speaking real estate transactions. You haul trucks and packing and moving so quick that your neighbors nor your mailman even get the gist of what happened, and add traveling to give you excuses for Carol's daughter, hear appointments and waxing, imagine dashing to fashion shows and laying on a beach with a Scrabble board. See, life is for the living, so I don't care about the dead relationships you had before. You have to know this is majestic. If you're tired of your favorite skirt, let's address it. We can discuss our financial future until you feel truly vested. I want to be domesticated, like ordering Netflix on a PlayStation, and intrigue you with my patience and promise to never leave you waiting. See, this is a swimsuit issue. I just met you and I already miss you, but I recognize opportunities knock, so how could I not stop? Try to open up your heart or at least get to stand at the windows of your soul until you give me permission to climb through. Cause the sunrise ain't never been breathtaking until I finally saw the sunrise behind you. Arielle, did you wanna, I was just doing a couple of poems until you got back. No, don't worry about it, okay. All right. There is something about the way she conjures the ancestors. She dances when she walks like she's from the Congo, pure. Convo like Asada Shakur says, brothers don't understand the science behind her self-reliance. She has a tattoo of Noble Drew on her neck and a tattoo of Marcus Garvey on her breast and says you got to have the presence of Martin Delaney if you ever hope to have a future in getting past her Malcolm X. She is smooth as Hennessy she's sipping as we listen to Horace Silver playing our third game of chess. And I can't help but stare into the natural texture of her hair. She compares George Padmore with C.L.R. James. And from there, she discusses Rodney's, how Europe underdeveloped Africa, and compares that to Kwame Nkrumah's neocolonialism, the last stage of imperialism. And as her lips move, I get lost in her rhythm. And as her thoughts move, I get lost in her wisdom. I love it when she sings CCY2 to the children. I love when we go on vacations and she puts that homemade sign on the door that says, do not disturb, nation building. She is Harriet Tubman, loving her people with a passion, fierce like that last chapter in Carter G. Woodson's Miseducation of the Negro Ego, conjure the ancestors after every poetry reading, breathing life into the souls that surround us like New Orleans, constantly calling me back. I bathe her in compliments. I wrap her confidence around my waist. I taste her ancestors' DNA every night because there's something spiritual about swallowing the same fluids that once coursed the physical forms of her predecessive slaves and tribes. And yo, you might think you know me, but if you ain't never seen me with her, then you ain't never seen me alive. I said, you might think you know me, but if you ain't never seen me with her, then you ain't never seen me alive. She goes from J.A. Rogers to Abubakar with her heart beats the rhythm of the Haitian Revolution, and she dances to it, singing the songs of the Cimarron colonies of San Salvador. And as she moves, there's something about the way she conjures the ancestors. There's something about the way she conjures my soul by day and by night. There is something about the way that she has conjured me back from the dead. There is something about the way that she conjures me continuously back to life. My mother's library had over 1,000 books, and her bedroom closet was cluttered with guns, and she helped raise her first grandson with a switch and a message. Her patience was not to be tested. A nurse who taught 2 languages and expected her progeny to excel. Quick to tell you tough titty, raised 4 children by moving back and forth between southern and northern cities, told my mother no way. Yeah, you and that baby can move in, but ain't no grown man moving into my house on no day. No pity. Bosom was warm, but the gangster was gritty. Pretty girl, piano player, singer, matriarch, cared for her parents for years while secretly dying of cancer, but still never let anything tear her family apart. My grandmother Eula English was my heart. My mother's mother was a school teacher, a black woman with a college degree in the 1930s and 40s. Long before these underachievers came up with excuses, would do whatever she could to make sure her descendants didn't end up shiftless and useless, use candy bars to motivate the children in the neighborhood to study the Bible because she believed that that was where the truth is. Ruthless when disrespected, connected nouns and verbs to put your self-concept in check, could be expected to rip your ego apart. Named after a city in Texas, my great-grandmother, Galvesta McNeil, was my heart. And her mother was a rider. Type to show up inside her son-in-law's living room, just take over, tell him, look, I'm like a general, and I raised my daughter to only roll with soldiers. Born in 1882, transcended 3 years before my start, famous for lighting cigarettes and putting men in their places, my great-great-grandmother Sally Giss was my heart. And my father's mother was a social worker, a black woman with a college degree in the 1950s who bought a house for her siblings and her parents and raised her 2 sons to either get educated or get busy. Told her husband, if I'm going on vacation, you could best believe my grandchild is always coming with me. Comprehended. Told my mother, if somebody steps to my grandson and gets knocked out, never punish me, but get suspended. Just ask him how did it start. My paternal grandmother, Flora Acey, was my heart. And my mother is a black nationalist with a master's degree in mathematics who's been programming computers since long before they had keyboards. I'm talking punch cards. And she never cared about my rough housing in the street, but if I ever disrespected her, I got punched. Hard. and hit with switches till I blacked out like those computer glitches. And if I came home with B's, she would make me study more to ensure I get the picture. Like tons of megapixels, she developed me to be sharp. Still my favorite person in the world. My mother, Jacqueline Acey, is my heart. I'm a father to my son. And I've been one since the beginning, but every advantage I've ever given him has been the product of five women. See, I'm every man in here. You got commitment issues, been there. Even been married, in fact, and somewhat prematurely, perhaps. It's better late than never, but if the first time's the charm, I pray the second time is better. Next time, I'll let her prove she's a team player first instead of rushing them backwards and expecting the worst. Because our time on this earth is too short, and maturity is knowing that what women want might not be what you thought. And two ears and one mouth means we could all stand to do twice as much listening. And maybe long-term peace is worth the temporary grief of giving in. And in this world we're living in, being a man means controlling your sentiment, because ain't nothing more important than doing everything you can to always be a gentleman. See, what's more attractive than class? And if she's with me, she don't touch her coat, doorknobs, nor pump gas. I give her the benefit of what my mother's upbringing has, and if you don't be treated with respect, then I'm sorry, I have to pass, because it ain't no fun if you can't be spoiled, and the royal treatment is all I do, and I ain't never satisfied till every woman passing by wishes she was you. I am every man in here. I got the same temptations and the same fears, got masculine problems and masculine language, masculine issues and masculine anguish, but you'd have to be a man to see me in anger. Women only get to see me at my tamest, my mellowest. I prefer female company, but my fellas always receive fellowship. Still admit this world is a lonely place when you ain't sitting across my beautiful face, maybe a little passion fruit and tangerine with some seafood hanging off your plate, and you're trying to be charming and make her day, yet every word you say is sincere. I don't aspire to be perfect, but I aspire to be perfect for you. I am every man in here. Likewise, I want my daughters to feel endeared. And for my son, I want to be the perfect example of father who also provides his woman with ample resources. And of course, it's easy to get all close and whisper something pleasing in your ear. But the challenge is to also be responsible. And I put that challenge to every man in here. Y'all don't have to clap or anything, but you know, just want to make sure you're still with me. I didn't lose you, did I? Okay. What'd you say?
I wasn't sure you were done.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah, yeah. With that poem, but not done. Ultramagnetic. When spoken word is done right, it's the most transcendental art form I've been said it. Feel like I need to write rings around things I already wrote and they're still calling me big-headed. Indebted to every lyric embedded in my spirit, I spit it until they swear it's like medicine to hear it. But do they really hear it? Somewhere out there, I believe their entire lakes of bromonide and high fructose corn syrup. If you can train fish to eat corn, then you can train people to trade spirits. Until they slow down, drop, wiggle-witted, preoccupied by earth suits, shiny minerals and drop coops, they need to know who's sexing who. They need to know who got loot. Like the rich could never control whoever they give money to. Like the media could never control whoever they give play to. Like public opinion could never control whoever the masses pray to. And when the world is this cold, those who still love love are the faithful. The degree to which you give is the degree to which you live. And as we know, there's some people so far from rich that the only thing they have is money. It's funny how time flies when you're willing to hide your third eye, when you're willing to buy into the state's lies and never go outside without your state-approved disguise. They say a word to the wise is sufficient. So how about omniscient, omnipotent, or omnipresent? But then again, how many words would it take to suffice for the irreverent? Like that college student told that reverend, "Don't pray in my school and I won't think in your church." And I'm considered confused because I refuse to subsist within a paradigm in which God only exists within the framework that Constantine terrorized the world with. And I praise God for every thought that I'm worth. And I pray for all those who had it so hard they feel unwelcome on earth. And please know it ain't near trial or tribulation that could halt your rebirth. And if you've got problems to fix, you should probably get with them, because it probably won't be too much time for problem fixing once you leave earth. And how unaware are the blessed that they would allow their development to be arrested, that they would allow the irrelevant and oppressive to come into their life and steal their light. And I share these words because I feel there might be something that wants to reach you. You know, one of those souls that often speak through vessels such as myself. Unenamored by fame and wealth in this world where so much pain is dealt, we see more. We see potential. We be that bridge from what you've been through to what it is you're trying to get into. So forget your poison, boys and girls. This is life without crutches. Probably one of the reasons most people don't want to mess with spoken word in the first place. This ain't money, holes, and clothes. This is life lessons on gracefully growing old. The truth's been told, but first you'd have to let go of those lying lenses you've been sold, because the only way to behold is to have faith in the soul and the mind. that God gave you. I can tell where your scars are just by the way you walk. And every assault that you have endured has ensured your every step. And you are blessed regardless of the animals that have attacked you. And you are pure no matter who has abused you. I know an angel when I see one. And when our kingdom come, it will be you, I, and the Son. And we will be one. We will create children, and our children will create us. Then every night by the light of the moon, I will kiss away your scars to Abby Lincoln tunes. And I will drink perfume that tastes like you out of a vessel with a waist like you. Then I will draw our bath water warm so we can soak until our souls are reborn. And you will be safe and secure in my arms, and it will always be this way. See, I can tell where your scars are just by the way you smile. And every night I walk a mile in your shoes, kiss away your tears and compile your blues till we choose to get sexy with Robert Johnson and Bessie Smith. And I will lick every bit from your soul's revelation to your pain's exodus. And when there's nothing left to sip, I'll massage the tension from your nakedness and then lift you in the most effortless way so you could just slowly ride all your pain away. And you should know they couldn't create a mirror that could begin to show you half the things that I see in you. Because more important than your face and your shape, I'm in love with the woman you're becoming. And I can foresee a day where your hair is mostly gray. And your smile shows intense living. And no one can look in your eyes without seeing decades of wisdom. And I'm not concerned with the woman of the year, because I'm in love with the bride of a lifetime. And I don't want to watch your figure. I'd rather watch you use your left and right mind. And I'm in love with your laugh more than the tightness of your abs. And though a mirror can show you your present, I'm obsessed with our future and our past. And my love lasts because it has the benefit of knowing that to truly be intimate, I don't focus on the qualities you have now. Instead, I focus on the qualities you have that are infinite. And that should be the sentiment that takes us all around the world to ocean liners and beaches and hotels and far reaches where we'll use stolen glances to communicate our secrets. And I hope our love is the one that teaches couples how to share their lives and men not to compare their wives with what seems greener on the other side. And I'll confide in you nightly, then provide for you daily, then in between do the best that I can to treat my fellow man fairly, but it's most important I'll be that eternal flame that brings you heat whenever you're cold. And you'll always see yourself clearer in me than any mirror, because I'm a pure reflection of your soul. It's a catch-22. Sometimes I will string three poems together and people won't know when they end it, and they'll be a little confused as to why I was talking about this at 1 minute and that and another. And then other times I just slow down and pause so you know that something ended. But again, it's just really intimate, so you don't have to clap in between the pieces if you don't want to. I get it. I think you're with me. Is that good? Is that correct? Okay. There I was, a 15-year-old cynic, sex life finished, penis getting hotter by the minute, and I'm stuck up inside this VD clinic, which was conveniently situated right across the street from my high school, which means anybody could have seen me sneaking in if they just peeked out the window of my homeroom. And I was pissed that I could no longer piss. And I knew that had to get fixed because the pain made me want to slit my little 15-year-old wrist, and besides, I thought it might fall off, and you see I had grown attached to my penis. So in the morning when I got dressed, I called up the operator, got the number for the clinic, talked to the receptionist to get the address, and was like, you're across the street from which high school? Why would you be anyplace else? That's just perfect. And I really wanted to go to school that day because we had been reading Roots by Alex Haley, and I was really hoping the teacher would tell me that why in the miniseries they were only in Africa for like the first episode, but in the book they were in Africa for the entire first half. And if the miniseries would leave out 400 pages of the existing African social structure, then the people watching Roots on television wouldn't think the slavery was quite as bad. Then I like pause for effect, just lay back in the cut for a second so the teacher would think that was all I had before I jumped right back at him. Like, besides, the book could have done a little bit more to talk about the history of slavery in Africa. It could have talked about how the white Mamelukes had been enslaved by the black Egyptians. Could have talked about how the black Carthaginian General Hannibal had virtually enslaved Italy on an elephant expedition. Could have talked about the Spanish Inquisition and how the people were being suffered if it wasn't for that, for a black general by the name of Tariq who conquered Spain by crossing the Rock of Gibraltar, otherwise known as Gibraltar Tariq, which was a cliff that bears his name, which so happens to be the same cliff that Prudential now uses as a logo. So I guess in that sense, we all on a piece of the rock. that I looked up at the receptionist long enough for her to see me looking down at my watch, because I had been there for a while. And as I looked up at her again, I noticed this thick, dark-skinned sister sitting across from me begin to smile, and I'm the type of brother that likes to play around like, what you in here for, dear? But then I thought about it a minute. I mean, if you don't want to get VD again, then the last thing you should do is try to pick up a woman that you meet inside the VD clinic. So I tried to play it off, and she asked my name, and I tried to play it off. Finally, I was like, oh, you talking to me? And without skipping a beat, I made up some BS lie, like, my name is Toby. And when you know that ghetto receptionist would take that opportunity to slide back the glass and call out my name, like, excuse me, Taalam Acey, and I didn't want to lose my turn, so I looked at that thick sister sitting across me, was like, oh, that Taalam stuff, that's just my slave name, baby. And as I'm sitting in the doctor's office getting nervous, looking at the needles, thinking about what she might do, I figured the easiest way to calm my nerves was to talk to her a little about our roots. So I began, isn't it tragic that the very same maritime skills that the Africans and Arabs helped the Spaniards and Portuguese to master will become the same skills they would use for our eventual capture, our eventual massacre? And isn't it tragic that they waited till the reign of Sony Bed Ali fell? And doesn't it seem like since the death of that black man, this world, at least for African men, has become a living hell? And she looked at me like, yo, who cares? Just don't drink any milk until you finish all these pills. Anyway, the next day I was back in school with my inject oranges with vodka crew, my soaked gummy bears and Everclear and stash porno mags and a locker crew. And they were like, yesterday in homeroom, everybody was watching you. And we understand you have to do what you got to do, but what we don't understand, when we found out that that clinic was right across the street, why didn't you take your 5-alarm having ass to the hospital? And I accepted all the advice they gave me, and did not try to play off my actions that previous day as bravery. But what gets me to this day is that people would rather hear about a 15-year-old with VD than their own ancestors' history of slavery. What if this is God's work? What if real poets walked the earth and lived lives fit for a prophet's birth, spreading ancient wisdom like the Coptic Church, and those that know what they're hearing know that they're hearing something special? And perhaps eventually a poet will be sent here just to bless you, test you in this world of lies, and if you feel your eyes cry because they recognize that what they're seeing is the truth, and the chills up your spine to provide absolute proof that in this now, where politicians and clergy are proving themselves unworthy of your time, and television shows and music videos are proving themselves unworthy of your mind, don't be surprised to find that God is especially present in poetry dens, guiding poets' pens, and not just those men who pretend to be closer to God than you, by making you ashamed of your sins when the lies that they've lived may not have been what God intends for your salvation. What if this is God's work? What if the Creator realizes that the creation is imperfect, but only wishes for us to worship sincerely, to not be hypocrites, but to really be concerned about our fellow man, to stand up against injustices falsely perpetuated in God's name in foreign lands? What if this is God's work? What if the poets are closer to Muhammad, Buddha, and Jesus than the preachers? I said, what if the poets are closer to Muhammad, Buddha, and Jesus than the preachers? I mean, think about it, y'all. Which of us are living closer to the streets, and which of us are living closer to Caesar? Which of us are living high up on the hog, and which of us are the poor righteous teachers? What if this is God's work? And if so, then poetry is sacred. So ye poets be concerned, just step up on this stage with them, be on your job, because if this is God's work, then stealing from another poet is the same thing as stealing from God. And it's not about your use of sexuality or profanity. It's about whether you use your tools for ahs and oohs, or whether you use your tools to improve humanity. What if this is God's work? And I know blasphemers have hell to pay, so I wouldn't say anything to y'all today that I wouldn't be comfortable repeating on Judgment Day. What if this is God's work, y'all? Let us pray. Since I've been calling, I haven't written a lyric. I mean, why should I when I can call upon spirits with rhythms and flows that dance like Africans who slaved on rubber plantations in the Belgian Congo, whose souls blaze more brilliant than Leopold's? And even tonight, as new graves grow cold and chlorofluorocarbon warm up the globe, they live like that deep-ass John Carpenter flick. I mean, can we agree that the Orisha still permeates Santeria? Can we agree that Bordone has made itself at home in the Catholic Church? And if so, then when you see me amongst the leaves, don't think that I'm praying to the trees, I'm praying through the trees, just like this poetry is now playing through me. See, I am a vessel, but unlike the good ship Jesus, I float in the direction which the actual Son of Man teaches. See, death is like a prison full of souls that had to surrender, but the inmates can still make things happen from the outside if you help to propagate their agenda and tree roots, constellations, rivers, and streams. These are the evidence of things not seen. Think the Haitian Revolution was just Toussaint and Dessalines? No, that was the evidence of things not seen. They say superstition is the name that the ignorant give to their ignorance, and there must be a lot of superstition going around because cash has a spiritual significance with pyramids and acacia trees and signs and symbols of deities taken from my Kibalan libraries and now permanently stored in the Vatican. And who am I? I'd be your operator, patching you into the infinite. If sex was death, we would be intimate, yet never reaching a climax, counting millenniums like days, intertwining my destiny with the stars like runaway slaves. You can trace my existence through drawings on caves, yet we submit to the same God. My job to make you conscious of your subconscious, bring you to a new trance dance every time your mind gets aligned with parallel galaxies that the Pharisees could barely see. Prepare to be taken to your ultimate destiny, where your test will be to call me, and ye should be worshipped. But instead, you're surrounded by a perfect circus of clowns. And worthlessness abounds because purpose isn't found among cheap talk and overpriced drinks and men who think that money is the answer but lack the capital to pay you attention, pay you a compliment, or even wait for you to ask a question. It's typical aggression, pressing for connecting with the temple that they lack the capacity to understand, like a pre-programmed barbarian at the gate that can't wait for the opportunity to rush your altar and obtain the holiest of holies. At first, he had you with a swagger, but every second that he talked, he slowly messed it up. And I don't know if I believe in fate or soulmates, but I definitely believe in magnetism. And if he can't match your rhythm, then the oscillations of his pendulum should probably swing someplace else on this earth. Maybe he should start out at a storefront church. He is beneath your cathedral. He needs to learn to perfect the quality of his verses, especially if he can't understand that you should be worshipped. Worshipped like an icon. Like a monolithic pylon surrounded by ionic columns and marble floors, because you deserve more than some jerk sitting next to you at the bar talking about he misplaced his number, could he borrow yours? Or sitting there flashing money, asking what would happen if he stuffed your pockets with 20s, trying to entice you with a resource of which you have plenty, and if you had any interest, it was diminished by the quality of his verses. What type of maniac doesn't understand that you should be worshipped? Worshipped. But instead, he's looking at your skirt with lust. And classless men turn women into mind readers, and still some women believe that they could change him, fix him, train him to get on his knees and meditate on them like a religion, give him the opportunity to fill your chapel with hymns and a chorus, hoping he'll rise to the occasion 14 times like Horace's father. But why bother to try to change a brute into a priest if his level of exegesis will never be venerable, will never be memorable? He lacks the level of levity necessary to levitate your basilica above the surface. And until you begin to perceive men's energy, you'll never see the degree of spirituality with which you should be worshipped. This was encoded with 0 degrees of encryption. So if you got any game with the English language, it should be easily understood. It's part Treme, part Jersey Drive, part Boys in the Hood, part The Wire. This is insomnia-induced enigma. Bigger than a Jim Crow rock star trying to sing the blues with B.B. King and Howling Wolf in the colored section and John Lee Hooker and Muddy Waters in the back shining shoes and Lil Walter and Sonny Boy Williamson working as attendants in the restroom and the junkies in the alley fixing to nod off to Etta James and Willie Dixon. Y'all ain't listening. Y'all can't envision this. This is the future of hip-hop as prophesized by Melly Mel and T. La Rock, provided we had decided to delineate crack music from rap music. Thus and ergo, before souls became predisposed to imagine themselves as superficial materialistic killers and imagine women as superficial materialistic hoes. And alas, it came to pass that ass was willing to trade potential for glamour and provide incentive for record execs to become circumspect and invest in Arm & Hammer futures, graveyards, ammunition, HMOs, sutures, anything death-related to the point that they investigated which DNC equipment providers could be publicly traded, then made it popular to become a defendant and took long positions in CCA prisons since legalized prison slavery was written into the 13th Amendment. So who picked cotton for free? Our enslaved ancestors. Who sews cotton into jeans for free? the imprisoned descendants, while producer DJ studies sound waves in order to modulate 808s to create confusion. This is the Simon and Garfunkel sound of silence mixed to the music of Stevie Wonder's contusions. Not quite an illusion, yet alluding to the fact that I have to keep reading because an idle mind will make his idols mine. And self-respect is a vital sign. And figurative sleepwalking is how losers bide their time. And I'd rather be a scholar and a bon vivant. So what you want, you can predict. Predict your future by what you flaunt. This is self-inflicted contextual meningitis, all transformed through brainstorms and the old haunts of dead Harlem Renaissance writers. I guess I just understand that life is cold blues, because strife is old news. It's like I sold jewels to the already initiated, the already bored and satiated in poetry venues, while the masses remain emaciated and the struggle continues, and spoken word artists are like sweatshop workers with sagacity spindles, and our pen moves from right to left as we reach out to the forlorn and bereft. And after I finish rocking, your own soul is up next. Since I've gotten older, loved unchanged. From is you is or is you ain't my baby to can we build a life together? Can we struggle through trouble and strife and weather the storms that transform most couples post-nuptial past the I do's and I will's and adapt to values? And when I kneel, I'll realize that the hardest times are ahead of me. But as long as your image is ahead of me, then all I see is success. Past undressing you with my eyes, past mine being the current on your life's experience with God's, because anything before me was just practice, and anyone afterwards would still be completely backwards, because what you gonna do with a queue of actors and half-wits when you've already been exposed to the truth? Since I've gotten older, love done changed. From is you is or is you ain't my baby to nothing ventured, nothing gained, nothing built, nothing maintained. Whatever doesn't kill us makes us stronger. And if we could master whatever that is, then our legacy will long for the longer. To my arms belong to having your back, and my lips belong to the nape of your neck. To whenever you think of me, all you think of is commitment, upliftment, and mutual respect. Our love is like a mic check, but instead it's a life check. So whenever you want to feel alive, whether you're awake or you're asleep, all you have to do is look by your side. And so you've known many empty nights of loneliness, but now they'll all be filled with me, inner peace, and God. Since I've gotten older, love done changed. From is you is or is you ain't my baby to I want to be the sanctuary of your relief. I'll be that pain remover that alleviates your grief no matter what erupts, nothing to be able to keep you down, because I'll be too busy lifting you up to the peak, the pinnacle, the summit. Let all that randomness and BS just plummet, because whenever we want to keep it 100, know that whenever we're together, we're at home. I want to be the firmament that ensures, I'll be the permanence that endures your life. Since I've gotten older, love doesn't change. From is you is or is you ain't my baby to is you is or is you ain't my wife. So I'm going to do one more poem, all right? How are y'all? Are y'all good? I'm not insisting that you're not. I just want to hear it from you. You good? Okay. I wish I had a beautiful story for this one, this poem, that I'm going to finish with. It's called Who Made This World? And I wrote it for myself. I wrote it because, you know, I was suicidal. So I wrote it to encourage me. It's just interesting because there was a time that I wish I had shared it with someone when I was writing that the poem God's Work that I did earlier. I was writing that poem, and I was writing the poem that I did about my mother and my grandmothers. Another one called Sell Hell, which I was having a ball with. I don't even know if I still remember Sell Hell that well. Let's see. I don't believe in hell, but we could sell it. I said, I do not believe in hell, but we could sell it. Tell them we're the anointed agents of salvation, sinners. The only way to be forgiven is if you're living within a system of precepts and suppositions that we prescribe. Tell them a book that was assembled by the Nicaea Council from a hodgepodge of religious texts was literally written by God. Think for yourself and burn in hell. Infernal blazes, ignites hair, singes bone, melts faces into the faceless. We alone determine what faith is. Heaven may or may not exist, but they need to believe. We hold the keys to eternal peace. Christ said, the only way to the Father is through me, and the only way to Christ is through us. Plus, tell him there's a demon powerful enough to the Father, almighty creator, and we're the ordained soul negotiators, and they will pay us to save them from hell, which I don't believe in, but we could sell it. I mean, they're already scared. They're already living amongst violence, disease, decadence, and fear. They're already living amongst rank smells, garbage, ghetto slums. This is hell on earth, and to keep our influences and convince them that the afterlife can be even worse. I mean, it's the oldest game in the world, so we might as well keep playing it. Just like the Egyptian god, amen, ain't got nothing to do with Christianity, but it works, so we keep saying it. Just like the Old Testament has about as much to do with the new as it has to do with the Quran, as it has to do with hellish wars like the Crusades and the conflict in Vietnam. Tell them God commanded tyrants to destroy entire families and leave no man, woman, or child behind. Don't allow them to know that God is love. Tell them God is vindictive and jealous. Tell them God ain't for the peaceful and the tolerant. God is for the superficial, self-righteous zealots in which the simple and judgmental are relished. Oh, I do not believe in hell, gentlemen, but I promise you we could sell it. So I was writing that poem and having a ball writing it. And in the room, I was doing a show for a college. And in the room across the hall was a young lady who had been brought to the college to do public speaking. And I remember she wanted to talk while I was there, but I was so busy writing my poems, you know, those three poems. The one about my grandmother, my mother, is called Five Women. The one about, you know, God's work and sell hell. The motivational speaker, after that performance, has sadly committed suicide. So I wish that I had shared this poem with her. I wish that we had talked. You know? But like I said, it was originally written for me. Who made this world where my wife's man or her husband are not one and the same? Where poets are extremely talented, but some of them vain, act like they'd be willing to bust one of your brains, especially when they start gunning for name. I swear, the more things change, the further I go insane. I'm shell-shocked. I ain't no good for no woman no more. Perhaps I should just barricade myself in here with my daughters. It don't seem correct to subject some innocent woman to my marriage-induced post-traumatic stress disorder. Sometimes I think this living room couch is gonna become my from here on out living quarters, and that eventually, after continuously waking up here, my eyes are just gonna well up with water. I mean, a lesser man would just do it, but I would rather be crucified than commit suicide. And any hustler, whether they be dead or alive, would recognize that the look in my eyes is strictly do or die. Besides, people that commit suicide must not believe in God. Otherwise, they'd understand that there's a rhyme and reasons why this life gets so hard, and they would put their nose to the grindstone and get used to the taste of their own blood, because life is a monster of a mobster, and you got to get your chops up if you wish to associate with that known thug. This world is like the Wizard of Oz, and until you show some heart, you don't never get shown no love. So when you're feeling desperate, think you done gave all you got to give, and you ask yourself, who made this world? The answer is simple. You and your actions did. And if you don't like the way the life you live is changing, then isn't it just as obvious that you must live your life to change the way you live? Happiness is mathematic. That's all it is. Happiness is mathematic. That's all it is. Happiness is mathematic. That's all. Thank you. Questions, comments, testimonials, confessions. Yes?
You said that you were working on three poems at one time when you were writing that. Are you always working on...
Not when I was writing that one. Like, I already had that one, and I wished I had shared that with her, but I did not know. I try not to make a joke out of it anymore. I mean, it's not funny, and yet the irony that who knows that the motivational speaker is suicidal, you know what I mean? But that's what turned out to be, you know. So I know I was saying I wish I had shared that poem with her, but I was writing the poem God's Work. I was writing Sell Hell, and I was writing five women.
So is your writing process always like that? Are you always working on multiple ones?
My writing process, this is gonna sound presumptuous as hell, but to an extent, it could be inspiring, my process, because people, a lot of writers struggle with what they call writer's block, and I don't even believe in it. I just believe in these gestation periods. And because I believe in these gestation periods, if I go 9 months or a year and don't write a poem, I don't freak out. I know that somewhere inside there are poems writing themselves, and when the time is right, they'll come out. So, like, unlike the person who says, you know, I have to write something every day, or a person who's like, I haven't written a poem in 5 weeks, and they go crazy, or I haven't written an essay, or I haven't written whatever they write, you know, a short story. Me, it doesn't matter. I don't care. The longer the time between poems, the more spiritual I think the poem that is to be birthed will be. And oddly enough, after waiting these long periods, poems tend to come out in clusters. So maybe instead of writing a poem every 2 or 3 months and coming out with 4 to 6 poems at the end of the year, I might not write a poem for 6 months and then at the end of 6 months write 4 poems. You know? Mm-hmm. Yes?
When did you first kind of start like naturally doing poems as like a younger, as when you were growing up? And like also, when did you have that like aha moment of this is something that I want to do and I'm going to kind of pursue it in a minute?
I've been writing poetry since I was a child. I've been writing poetry since I was a child. The poetry was always around my house. You know, my parents were part of Mary Baraka's organization, as Arielle was gonna tell you earlier, but we kind of got crossed. She went out actually to round up more people, and then we just decided to start at the same time. But yeah, my parents were in Mary Baraka's organization when I was a child, and Mary Baraka's books, The Last Poet's books, Gil Scott-Heron's records, all of that was around the house. I've been writing ever since I was, you know, 4 or 5 years old. I didn't get into performance poetry until the 90s. And I knew the first time I saw performance poetry that it was something I had to do. And I'm still at a point where I don't feel like I've done it to the extent that I could, you know? And I think about it a lot more now than I ever did in terms of just, you know, what would be totally fresh and new and yet not outside of myself, you know? It's like you wanna come up with that shock factor, but the problem with shock factors is it's so easy to cross that line between being shocking and just playing yourself. Did that answer your question? Are there other questions?
Would you recommend starting out like in, just like coffee shops?
Yes, I still do perform at coffee shops and open mics, not as much as I used to. It's nowhere near as much as I used to. I used to find some way to perform almost every day. Like, I would just drive around looking for even poetry competitions and stuff, you know what I mean? And this is before, like, MySpace, but I would be, you know, Googling things or whatever, trying to find what was going on. And I do recommend that as a way of starting. I also, oddly, I recommend slams, not for the sake of winning them or being obsessed with winning them, because in most slams, the best poet tends to lose anyway. But just, it keeps you honest. When you're writing something that you feel like you could share in the safety of an open mic sometimes, you cheat yourself because you feel like, you know, no matter what I say, no matter what I do, they're gonna snap or clap or whatever. They're gonna be supportive and warm. It's a different type of writing when you know you're gonna be held to it, when people are gonna look at it and you're allowing them to judge you. When you're stepping on stage to be judged, you know, whether you win or not isn't the point, but there's something that keeps you a little bit more honest when you know that it's not anything you do or anything you write, but you better have, you know, written something and pulled it out of you as best and as clearly as possible. the other benefit of slams is that if you do it enough, you'll eventually end up on someone's slam team, which will bring you to regional slams, bring you to the national slams. And those are opportunities to meet poets from all around the world, to trade phone numbers, get names, and to be invited. You know, it was from the slams that I was invited to go. I slammed in New York, out of New York City at the New Eureka Cafe. From that point in 1999, we went to the National Slam in Chicago. It's from there that I ended up going to California and Florida and, you know, Canada. And then I went to Austin and did an international festival. And it was from there that I was invited to start doing things in London and Holland and Germany and so on and so forth. So that's another benefit of slams. Yes?
So obviously we're talking about, you know, something that is beyond currency. There's a, you know, life to be lived and experiences and truth and love. But like you said, finance and currency has a spiritual significance through those symbols or some kind of, not spiritual significance, but
They're spiritual symbols on monetary currency. So, you know.
I was just going to say that to bridge sort of how did you find like transitioning from just the need, like you said, you had to drive around just to find somewhere to perform, like the need to get that energy out there, and how did you transition that into something that you could support yourself? And because obviously you need funds
yes.
to continue doing that.
Yeah, and a coffee house, as you might imagine, or open mics, they didn't pay much.
Right.
But what we did was, in addition to struggling to write these poems and pull them out of, just like you dig deep and then you see what's there and you do everything you can to explain it, to make it as clear as possible to the person listening so that they can identify, and some will say, that's what I wanted to say, but could not put it in those words. And that's what you're trying to do with the poems. But we made a science, a whole separate science into how do you convince people now to purchase these poems. At first it was these little chap books that we were making at the print, you know, on copy machines. And then from there, eventually CDs. And we had a whole thing on trying to figure out how do you get people to buy CDs, because it was the CDs and the books that we were selling that was financed the ability to travel. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, there were times where I spent like $20,000 a year on plane tickets. So it was funny, it's like selling CDs for the airline.
Do you have like a specific poet that influenced you other than like your...
My favorite poet was, my go-to answer was always Gil Scott-Heron, who passed not too long ago. Mary Baraka is a favorite of mine as well, but I consider him as far more than a spoken word artist. You know, he's one of my favorite writers in general. Sonia Sanchez. I've been resisting telling y'all that I actually was with Sonia Sanchez yesterday, just by the sheer coincidence of me coming to be here with you. We just happened to be on the same plane coming up here. And it was a real beautiful experience, talking and so on and so forth, taking pictures and all that. Yeah. So I called my girlfriend and told her that I was, and this is like my fourth time meeting her, but you know, you don't expect people to remember you every time you meet them, so I always start over again. And I was telling my girlfriend on the phone that she was on the plane with me and whatever. She was like, wow, you know, she's one of my favorite poets. I always wanted, you know, to meet her. So as I was getting off the plane, Ms. Sanchez was saying, you know, was talking to me some more, and it was kind of like, is there anything else I could do? And I was like, yeah, can you do me one more favor? So I called up my girlfriend and gave her the phone, and she's like, hey, how are you? This is Sonia Sanchez. And you know, you could hear, you know, the excitement on the other end. And of course, later, when we were talking about it, she said that when she first heard a woman's voice, the first thing she thought was some drama was about to ensue. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you.